Hey guys, welcome back to 5 Live here on KTLA. An exciting day for us in the 5 Live studio. We have a renowned author, a fantastic editor, and a newly minted New York Times bestseller. Guys, welcome to 5 Live, my friend and author of Basketball, A Love Story, Rafe Bartholomew. Rafe, thanks for being here.
No, Scott, thank you. And yeah, last night, a friend of mine, it didn't even come from our literary agents or as someone who should know these things, friend just emailed and said, hey, you guys are on the New York Times bestseller list, which was, we'll take it. It's amazing.
I was going to say, is that something, there we go, Robert's pulling it up right now. Now look, on the New York Times sports and fitness bestseller list, behind Tim Tebow and been the number one spot. But there you are, there is you and Jackie McMullan who worked on this book with you. Is that something you ever thought when you started your career, you'd make that list?
When I started my career, man, I didn't even think I'd ever write a book, and I'm lucky enough to say this is the third one I've worked on, so absolutely not. And then even neither of the first two books came remotely close to making any of these lists. So no, I wouldn't say that. And it is a dream. Obviously, this is a book that has a lot of appeal. It's about the history of basketball. Tons of NBA legends are in there. Bob Cousy, Bill Russell, all the way through today's guys like Kevin Durant and LeBron. But still, you never know. And the first cover, it's been out for a few weeks now. So I kind of thought if it was going to happen, it would have happened already. Lo and behold, we got it.
Yeah. So to kind of walk everyone through the situation with the book is in concert with the film, the documentary that's currently out on ESPN right now.
Right.
Right. Same name, Basketball, Love Story. But you worked on this book with Jackie McMullan.
Yes.
And kind of took some of those same interviews and same process that Dan Klores had gone to make this film and turned it into a kind of completely separate book.
Right.
So walk me through that process. How does that happen? How do you go from here's a bunch of film and now you've got a new book and now Jackie McMullan's involved? That sounds like a lot. How did it bring me up to speed?
So it starts with Dan Klores, who's been working on the film for ESPN, Basketball, Love Story, for more than 5 years, six, seven. He's arranged and interviewed, well, the full list is about 165 different characters, executives, players, coaches, media, pretty much anyone you can imagine is in the film and the book. And there was over 500 hours of interview footage, and
so you watched all of the 500 hours.
Thankfully, I did not have to do that, nor did I have to transcribe these hours myself, which would have put me in the grave.
I was gonna say, who gets the credit on the book for that?
I met one of the guys who did it, and I almost fell to my knees and like kissed his feet. I couldn't even believe it was done by real human beings. I don't know how a computer could do it yet, but no, that what a monumental task. But what Jackie and I, so they brought us in because Dan realized he had so much, he also thought it was worth doing a book, an oral history book like this. So they sent us all the transcripts. It was like they dropped the Dead Sea Scrolls of basketball on the two of us and said, find the book.
Man, that sounds, so I've kind of thumbed through it. It is like these kind of separate chapters that work themselves around, and it's, in some ways it does kind of read like an oral history if people are familiar with that type of format. When you're going through there, that means though you didn't have to watch all 500 hours of film, but you did have to read all 500 hours worth of film transcript. So, as a basketball guy, now you and I know each other through basketball, was it heaven, and at some point did it just turn into hell?
Yeah, you nailed it. When I first saw it, it was like the gates of heaven are opening up. I'm like, oh my God, I can click on Phil Jackson. I can click on Kobe. I can click on Jerry West and just read whatever wisdom poured out of their mouths in these interviews. And then maybe 3 or 4 months into that process, as I had been reading hundreds of pages every day, and I looked and saw that there were still thousands more to get through, it started to weigh on me. But still, I mean, the honor, the privilege to be able to have seen those, that raw material, the original stuff, is really something special. I mean, only a few people in the world have.
Yeah, and I mean, in that way, it's almost kind of like you got the uncut version. Right. So people at home will go and watch this film, and they'll kind of see the best that Dan selected. And then people who read the book will see the best that you selected. But like, did that kind of wash over you too, where it's like, well, it's me? it's Jackie, it's a couple other people are like editors and publishers, and that's about it, that are like kind of have the treasure trove of all basketball kind of information.
Yes, and so Dan says there's, I don't know exactly how this is going to work out, but there are plans to eventually donate this material to the NBA and they'll archive it. But I don't know if they'll transcribe it. I don't know if it'll just be the footage. I don't know. So still, someone's going to have to watch it again. And it is it's a great experience for someone who loves the game, but it is totally overwhelming.
So walk me through one of the things you talked about. You have a couple of books that you've done before. One, the... Hold on, I gotta read the Pacific Rims, Bierman and Ballin in Flip Flops, and the Philippines' Unlikely Affair with Basketball. It's a strong, long first title. So this is your first book.
Yeah.
Walk me through, like, how did you go and decide, I want to be a writer, I want to combine basketball, and all of a sudden now, you're a guy from New York, yeah. And next thing you know, you're writing kind of what is, at least according to Twitter, the kind of Philippine Bible of basketball, which is right here in front of me.
Right.
How does that happen?
You know, in a lot of ways, I just fell into it. You know, my father is a bartender, and I grew up around that. But there was this story, I guess, it was storytelling. People are always telling stories in bars, and it just sort of got into my blood. And then I ended up going to journalism school, not really on the strength of any writing I'd done in high school. It was the best college I got into, so I went. And there I read a book by Alexander Wolf, a Sports Illustrated writer, where he went all over the world and did a chapter on basketball in these different places. There was 17 pages on the Philippines.
Okay.
And it blew my mind. I had never thought about basketball being played all the way on the other side of the world, and the idea that this country was so passionate about it, where people were building their own baskets out of whatever materials they could find, they were playing in bare feet and flip-flops, and that from the city to the countrysides to the tops of mountains, you were going to find basketball courts wherever, and it just sort of made me want to go there and learn about it, see it for myself, and was lucky enough to come out with that first book.
So you go, and actually, Robert, take this real quick. So that's one of those kind of iconic shots from the book of, you know, just guys playing in kind of any way they can. You go over there, you decide you're going to write this book, and then now, I mean, you speak Tagalog, right?
Yeah.
You've kind of fully immersed yourself in that world. You're now the basketball scribe of an entire country. When on Twitter, if you follow Rafe on Twitter, you'll see that it is lots of people from all over the world talking to him about basketball in another language. What, like, do you kind of sometimes wake up and go, well, I didn't see myself to be a country expert, but now here I am.
It is one of the strangest or most unexpected sliding doors stories I could come up with. And because if I hadn't read that one chapter in a book, I wouldn't have known really enough about the Philippines to think about it in any way other than your average American who's not Filipino-American and doesn't necessarily know the history, the culture, that people even like basketball there. And then now it's a whole alternate life for me. I go back almost every year. I've hosted television shows in Tagalog. My Tagalog is not that rusty. I'm still pretty good with it. And yeah, and I'm happy about it, man. I don't really ever want to let it go, because while I was there, I met, there's the, you know, expats come in and out of Manila or other parts of the Philippines pretty regularly, and a lot of the time they leave it behind, and I really didn't want that to become of me, and I'm lucky that I've had the opportunities to keep going back.
So one of the interesting things is, for those of you who are not kind of the huge basketball scribes in this and just kind of enjoy basketball as a game, one of the things that I noticed in the opening sequence of Basketball Love Story, the documentary, was, and it's in, you have parts of it in the book, where everyone seems to use the same language when they talk about how they fell in love with the game. And it doesn't matter their background, it doesn't matter what kind of role they've had in it, they just describe basketball as like art or ballet or jazz and the movement that goes into it. What is your relationship with the game?
I wouldn't be able, you've seen me play, man. I don't think I can say that my game is anything like art or ballet. I can, you know, I see the court pretty well. I could throw an artistic pass every now and then.
You got a corner three, that's, you know.
Sure, hey, just the ball swishing through the net. When you hit that shot, that sound, there's a little art to it. There's something, certainly to people who love the game, there's that beauty to it. And that's something I really loved about this project, and that reading the players' stories about how they first started playing,
yeah.
how they, the first time they picked up a ball, or the great 1970s and 80s center, Spencer Haywood, talking about how his mom, their family was too poor to afford a basketball, so his mom knitted one together out of a sack they had and filled it and stuffed it just with cotton, and that they had to, instead of dribbling, they just imagined they were dribbling, and then two imaginary dribbles in one shot. And just, you know, there are stories that are the way I think about how I love the game, and to hear that coming out of the voices of the people that are the best to ever play it, that's something inspiring about it.
Yeah, that was kind of, we only have so much time to talk basketball, but I want to have kind of two more questions. The first question is, you're a writer, but also your day job is, you're an editor. You're currently the features editor at Eater.
Yeah.
And what's the difference kind of in that process where you go from, here's a book, I write it myself, and I kind of do go through the process, and all of a sudden, your other job is to take what other people write and say, well, it could be better, or let's change this. How do you kind of balance that, like those two separate identities? Because in some ways, a lot of times writers and editors, you want to work, you kind of together, but a lot of times you butt heads. So what is that? Do you have that in your own brain with yourself? Where you're like, this is a great line. Actually, no, it is not. It is a terrible line.
Well, a big part of what any writer does is self-editing, right? Writers are constantly revising their own work, unless it's something like Jack Kerouac, or you're doing some stream of consciousness, really out there thing. Most of us are going, editing our own work, and still it is great to have a good editor come in and improve it. And I think as long as I try to be nicer when I'm in the editor role. I'm not, because it sucks to have an editor come in and tell you, this is terrible, get this out of here. Even when it's true, there are better ways to say it, there are better ways to express it. And the idea is I just sort of put myself in the shoes of that writer, and how is this sentence, and then the next sentence, and then the whole story going to be the best possible version of what this writer's trying to say?
Yeah, that's got to be, it's going to be a lot of fun around other people when they're constantly like, oh, I shouldn't say this. Rafe will think I'm stupid. No. Final thing. 2 and 2, one of my favorite books, another by yours, another long title, 2 and 2, McSorley's My Dad and Me, the legendary bar in New York City, McSorley's. And you said in the book, you kind of talk about growing up there and being around storytelling. Just talk to me about the kind of ability to then encase some of those stories and kind of share that experience. It seems like your father have a really special relationship that comes out in the book. Was that something that, like, as an homage or something to go forward? Or was it something that the stories itself you thought was enough to carry it?
I just think what a honor to be able to write a story like that about my dad and his career. You know, not too many kids get to explain their own relationship with their father, especially when it's a good one, yeah. in the pages of a book. And this was really celebrating the life he's made for himself as a career bartender at McSorley's, which in New York, you know, I don't know if everyone in LA knows, is
LA, if you go to New York, go and check out McSorley's, located?
15 East 7th Street between 2nd and 3rd Avenues in Manhattan.
Every time someone goes to New York, they say, well, give me a recommendation. There's your recommendation. You got it right there.
My father still works there. He's been there for 46 years now, and he's trying to hit 50. And, you know, it was just, so to be able to write that story about the bar, the place I grew up in, all this really personal stuff, it's something you never dream you're going to get an opportunity to, and you just hope that you live up to it in the pages.
Well, I mean, it's a great read. I really enjoyed it. I think it's a wonderful story about kind of coming of age and the things you experience. Robert, take my take the 2-shot here. We're going to go, okay, 1, 2, 3 books. Rafe, I'm not going to say how old you are, but you're young enough that seems very impressive. Do you feel good about yourself?
Yeah, hell yeah.
I got him. Tell everybody, though, where you can find Basketball Love Story and also find the film.
Sure. So Basketball Love Story is available at any bookseller, of course, online at Amazon, Barnes & Noble, IndieBound, if you want to support independent bookstores, which is a nice thing.
Yeah.
Any brick-and-mortar bookshop.
Films on ESPN, and it's airing. It's already, some of it's come out, but it's 20 hours of film content that is airing in
4-hour time blocks every Tuesday. The premiere was this past Tuesday.
Right.
Every Tuesday from now on, there will be 4-hour time blocks that'll be on ESPN. and that'll add up to 20 hours, but it's going to live online on ESPN Watch and ESPN Plus pretty much forever, and you can watch it. It's really organized in short bursts, short stories, 62 short stories about basketball.
Yeah, it's super fun. If you're a basketball fan, check it out. If you like stories, check it out. Also, I thought one of the things that's in the book and on the film series is, in the documentary, is talking about the women's game and kind of the evolution of that. There's so much, obviously, when you have 500 hours of tape, there would be. Rafe, I want to thank you again for coming in. Our first New York Times bestseller here on 5 Live, so that's exciting. And we'll be right back after this. Oh, and we're going to hang around and get some thoughts on a basketball expert, how the Lakers are going to do this season. We'll have all that and more when we come back.